We've always perceived ourselves as people of freedom. Freedom of equality. Of human decency. Of the right to live without fear. These freedoms have been given to us by many who sacrificed greatly. And somehow, we've believed that the war has been won. That we have arrived. But if we open our eyes, we can see that the dream has not yet been fully realized. That there are still battles to fight. Still inequalities present. Still souls suffering. That our faith demands more than awareness. And that no generation is exempt from these battles. But we are held responsible to stand, to do justly, to love mercy, and to serve the least of these.
I wonder if we are really happy and satisfied with the life that we're living right now. And I wonder if, in fact, most people my generation are stuck in such a cycle of the mundane that they forget how glorious and exciting and adventurous life can be when we're living in the kingdom.
It was more than a turning point. I would say it was even something to the effect of a renaissance in my life, just an awakening to things besides myself.
I know that I'm not the same man that I was going into it. I've been humbled, broken, beaten down, wrecked, completely wrecked, and all the better for it.
It allowed me to see a different side of God and Jesus, and it became real to me.
I thought I knew who I was, and I thought I knew who God was, but it was very narrow. I guess, idea of what it was to be a Christian and what it was to really understand this love relationship with my father.
It's like I bust out of a box and I realized who I really was, that I wasn't this person that the world defined, but I was this person that God defined.
For me, it was a journey of seeing 11 different cultures, 11 different foods, 11 different currencies, 11 different religious systems, and realizing that at the end of the day, everyone needs hope. Everyone in the world needs hope.
It's really taken me outside of myself, and something I wouldn't give up, something I wouldn't change.
Because now I'm in a place where I feel completely moldable and ready to be used.
What if my hands are yours, God? What if my feet really are yours? And all of a sudden, then the feet of Jesus are walking into the bar of Thailand. The hands of Jesus are holding the dying orphan. And in that moment, that's when heaven invades earth.
You're kind of doing the thing that Jesus did. You know, they say when wherever Jesus went, health and healing broke out. And so there were cool times where we went, health and healing broke out.
And that everywhere we go and everything that we do, there is an impact that it has eternal value.
I wonder if you could say that what Jesus promised in John 10:10 of life abundant is being lived today.
I want you to ask yourself the question, is this my life? And is this what I want my life to be? Because the world race isn't the answer, but the journey is the answer. And there's a journey that God wants to take you on.
It was a chance to say, this isn't what life is supposed to be about. There's more. And it was a chance to actually go after more.
You're gonna be awakened to a reality and a destiny that you had no idea you were made to fulfill.
I think in a nutshell, the World Race is going beyond what we see the church here, what we see God doing here.
Bottom line is, Jesus calls us to love other people. And all that really means is stop looking at yourself and look at others.
And learn what it means to not live everything according to me and for me.
How to be the will of God in someone else's life.
Be love to people and be hope to people, because so much of the world doesn't have it.
It creates a domino effect. And so it's more than just us doing it. People see us doing it and they want to recreate that and do it themselves. There's something else deep inside of you, and there's something that could be bigger and better, and you know there's a destiny just locked in there, and you don't know how to get it out.
Then go on a journey of initiation, because God wants to reveal it to you, and it's going to be better than you ever could have possibly imagined.
My generation has no future, and I refuse to believe that I have been given permission to live and I am free. I realize this may be a shock, but God has a purpose for my life is actually a lie, and I believe money and popularity are priorities. In my lifetime, I will tell the people closest to me, I have my priorities straight, and I must hold on to my pride. I surrender the idea that my actions will have an everlasting impact. In the future, lukewarm beliefs will be the norm. No longer can it be said that my peers and I care about our faith. It will be evident that my generation is apathetic and lethargic. It is foolish to presume that there is hope. But what if we change that? What if we shatter those expectations? What if we flip the script? There is hope. It is foolish to presume that my generation is apathetic and lethargic. It will be evident that my peers and I care about our faith. no longer can it be said that lukewarm beliefs will be the norm. In the future, my actions will have an everlasting impact. I surrender the idea that I must hold on to my pride. I have my priorities straight, and in my lifetime, I will tell the people closest to me, money and popularity are priorities. It's actually a lie, and I believe God has a purpose for my life. I realize this may be a shock, but I have been given permission to live, and I am free. And I refuse to believe that my generation has no future.
My race. More than the color of my skin or the language I speak. More than a 5 or 10K. More than a run in the park or waiting for the sound of the gun to blast to activate my stride. My step, my course, destiny in the making, purpose for the taking. Awakened in a season where I'd forsaken the reason for my being, the reason for my seeing. The reason for my hearing, my speaking, my life, my choice, my race. My longing to dispose of a comfort and a fear that's recycled and reused me for too long. Too many tears not poured into the right soil, the right soul. Too many years not reaping the right harvest, the right mind set in my ways. Reevaluating my calling because I couldn't calculate it. Reconsidering convenience because I couldn't handle the leaving of home, the known for the unknown. The digital follow me's that have kept me at ease, appeasing the heart of me, keeping the real followers at a distance for the scarred of me. Status quos, FB statuses for real life and unpredictable challenges to grow and break the rest of me. Realizing that all of him is the only best of me for them to see. I lost part of me in the process, part of me in the nonsense, part of me to get sense but not change. My life is worth more than dreams that keep me dreaming and people waiting. Keep me waiting and people dreaming. About a love so deep it keeps them gasping for his air. His breath to keep them breathing, his word to keep them believing. Longing for more of him in the form of me, and me longing for more of him in the form of them. So I go.
There's a whisper that's inside all of us that says, there must be more. There is more. There's an amazing, epic life that God has called us all to live. Jesus said, go and preach the gospel, heal the sick, raise the dead. We believe that he desires for his disciples to go out in the same way in this modern day.
The World Race is an 11-month mission trip to 11 different countries. We spend 1 month in each country working with the local churches and organizations to meet the needs of each community while spreading the gospel.
Ministry on the race looks a lot different from month to month.
We will preach in churches,
door-to-door ministry,
visit kids in orphanages,
do construction work,
minister to sex trafficking victims.
We do whatever it takes to bring God's kingdom to earth and share his love around the world.
And in the midst of serving, you learn that Jesus changes you way more than you could ever change the people that you come in contact with.
The World Race is an opportunity to come and find out who God is calling you to be and to start to implement that into your life.
We get the privilege of serving him and making a difference, making an impact to 11 different countries for his kingdom and his glory.
The World Race is for people who want more than the 9-to-5 and more than the status quo.
It's the most challenging and the most rewarding thing that you will ever do.
The World Race is for people that are ready to leave their comfort zone, to love the way Jesus loves, and to live radically for the sake of the gospel. There's more out there than your hometown and where you grew up. God will use you to change the world.
There's a generation that has heard the whisper. They know that if they'll just step out, God will use them to build his kingdom.
Normally, who finds us on the World Race are people that are trying to find themselves. I always talk to people about the fact that you have a whisper or a rumor of something more, something different, something unique, something you haven't yet tapped into on the inside of you. I believe that that's the kingdom. And so the World Race, while being this trek around the world, is an opportunity for you to come out from where you are and to come into where you might be able to come into, to come into the destiny that God has for you. The process is pretty simple, yet it's brutal. We take you completely from where you've been and all of your comfort, and you reduce your whole life into a backpack that probably weighs about 50 pounds. You abandon all the things that are normal, all the things that are safe, all the things that are protected. And through a process of 11 months, you begin to develop not a dependency upon systems and structures and mom and dad, but you begin to develop a dependency upon God. Why do I recommend the World Race? Hey, listen, you need to be initiated. The American society doesn't give you any opportunity at all to find out what a man really is and what a woman really is. You just all of a sudden one day get out of college, get married, and there you're supposed to be equipped for the rest of your life. And the World Race actually puts you on a pilgrimage to find him, to find yourself, so that you might become the person you were called to be. It's all about initiation. Everybody comes into the early adult years with this big old vision about changing the world. The reality is you can't change anything until you're changed first. So it goes back to this process of initiation, of you emptying out systematically all the stuff that was previously you, and begin to fill every crack, every crevice, every void in your life with the kingdom of God. And the intention is that the kingdom wouldn't stay within you, but that the kingdom of God would be released through you. John chapter 7, streams of living water would begin to gush forth. And everywhere that this now supernaturally empowered, fire-breathing World Racer goes, the kingdom of God begins to gush forth. It begins to create a river of life, a river where people can find wholeness and health. We don't change things politically. We don't change things through the Peace Corps. We don't change things by picketing. We change things by being in the middle of the world and releasing the kingdom of God.
Coming into Passion, that the Lord has something for me. And it's happened every year. I've learned something new, not only about who I am in Christ, but who God is and what His plans are for this earth.
Right here, right now, in Houston, Texas. We gotta lift up the biggest shout we got tonight. Come on, come on.
Well, welcome to Passion 2014. Welcome to Jesus Christ, the risen Son of God.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down.
Same God that spoke the world into being, same
God that created time and space, the same God that reigns over all things. He has come close. Jesus is near. He is the only one that can save, and he saved me.